always so excited to do Total Education with Neil. At least I can see live people instead of when I do my radio show in my studio. I just talk to people on the phone. But always excited about great education talk, and I always have to have my great co-host Jared with me. Jared, how are you?
Thank you, Neil. I'm doing very well, and can't wait to be, I'm so glad to be back here in the studio.
Well, I'm excited to talk to you and a lot of interesting things. And one of my interesting developments is a colleague of mine who was one of my first major guests on the radio. And things have changed dramatically in probably 2.5 years since I met her, Dr. Shelly Hipsky. And we have both, our careers have taken off in the entertainment world through television and radio since then, unbelievably. But I am honored to have her come back to the studio today. Dr. Shelly, thanks for stopping by.
Delighted to be here. Thank you
again,
for having me on the show.
So can you tell us a little bit about our background for our viewing audience that might not know who you are?
Absolutely. So I am a education professor, an associate professor at Robert Morris University. That's my main job. And then I have a company called Inspiring Lives with Inspiring Lives. And underneath that umbrella, there is a television show called Inspiring Lives with Dr. Shelly. Our radio show Empowering Women, which is awesome. Five books, including Ordinary People, Extraordinary Planet, which went really well internationally. And I do a lot of speaking from Oxford University in England to I have a big cruise ship in Cozumel that I'm going to be doing Women on Board for Success this next coming up year. So I'm having a blast helping women and children and in the classroom and out of the classroom.
Very busy person.
Yes.
Jared, she's very busy.
Very busy.
And you thought I was busy.
I did. I sometimes wonder how you were able to do it. I'm imagining that it's probably hard for Neil or me to get a ticket on that cruise ship now.
Probably would be, yes, absolutely. But there's going to be a lot of wonderful women there, so I'm excited about that. And that's with the Women Small Business Association, and they just gave me the 2013 Best Businesswoman in Pittsburgh Award through that.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
It's amazing how the career continues to take off, but the way we connected was through a foundation you're working with, and I have learned much about it, even went to one of the events, the Homeless Children's Education Fund, mm-hmm. and it's something that I don't know how many families out there know, and listeners and viewers know, that there are many kids that go to school that don't have a home, they're homeless.
Absolutely, and it's very much a hidden problem throughout America. And when we've done different radio shows and things like that, we brought on Joe Lagana, who is the founder of the Homeless Children's Education Fund, and he has just this amazing mission. He's an incredible man who was a superintendent of schools, and he went into one of the homeless shelters, and these kids had nothing to do. They were just, you know, running amok, and he gave them a book. Well, he went back almost a year later, and they came up to him, and they were like, Dr. Lagana, I still have this book. And he was like, gosh, if they still have that book, they need more. They need resources. So once he retired, he decided to take his retirement money that he got at his little shindig, his little party, and he took that to spearhead the Homeless Children's Education Fund. And that has been absolutely amazing, particularly for the children of Pittsburgh, because there are around 1,000 kids in and out of these shelters during the year. And the Homeless Children's Education Fund they're set up right in the shelters, in about 13 different shelters. They bring in tutors, textbooks, computers, and they really make it a home space for them so that they can continue to learn, even though their lives are in this very often, uncomfortable transition phase.
Consistency and stability seem like it would be probably the greatest challenges facing the children and their families within this structure and this community.
Yes.
What are some of the other challenges regarding specifically education that you see with children in these circumstances and situations?
Absolutely. And I can speak to that from multiple different perspectives. I can speak to it as an education professor, as a former teacher and assistant principal, where I had my kids and I was so worried about them not having a place to lay their head at night. Some of them were living in cars, some of them were living in the houses, in the home shelters. And then I also go into the shelters with my little girl, and we help out in the shelters together. And I've seen firsthand that some of these kids feel broken. I mean, there's a confidence issue. There's stability, like you said. One of the slogans for HDEF has been, how do you do your homework without a home? Right. And you think about, you know, what we provide. I'm a single mom of two kiddos, and I think about what I can provide for my kids and how I can take care of them. I can nurture them and, you know, sit down with them and do their homework. But there's mothers out there that are scrambling to survive. And if mommy's doing that or daddy's doing that, and these kids are just kind of sitting there going, what about me? How am I going to make that transition into being a stable, healthy adult someday?
And Neil, I know this is your show, but this is such an incredible topic.
Absolutely, and we've talked. You were in the studio when she
right.
came in,
and we've talked about the passion that we have associated with our radio show and our TV show with really specific educational goals and needs. But this is a topic that I find so timely,
yes,
so enlightening, and sometimes I think as a society, when we have so much, we forget mm-hmm. of the people that really have so little.
Yes.
And sometimes we assign blame to that. And I think what I'm seeing here is that this organization is throwing the blame game out the window.
Absolutely.
And what they're saying instead is, what can we do to get in there? What can we do to provide a need? And I want you to focus on that word confidence. You use the word confidence
yes.
there. And broken. Mm-hmm. What happens? What have you seen with this organization? Mm-hmm. What have you seen them do to regain or instill new confidence in these families?
Absolutely. Well, one of the things that my company, Inspiring Lives, does is we go out and we make a difference within the shelter settings and throughout the world globally to restore confidence, to empower, to inspire. And we joined up with HCEF to do a mommy makeover. And I know that sounds like fashion for, you know, like, but it was amazing that we went into the shelters. We went with Treasure House Fashions. They dressed the moms from head to toe so that they could have the confidence inside to be able to go out and make a living for their children. We also helped out the kids, and we did some activity. My students from our Morris Education Department went over and helped out with the kids, and we painted a mural with them. But we got to do these family photographs at the end of the day. And for a mother to be able to have that picture, that keepsake, we can go to Target, we can go to a photography studio and get a picture taken of us and our kids. But for them to physically be able to see that moment of them and their children, how they should be envisioning themselves down the road.
Yes.
It was a really powerful experience for everyone involved with that. And I'm thankful to Alive and Spa for coming out and doing the hair and makeup and everything for those ladies. Because there was, and I know you know this story, Neil, because from the radio show, but there was a woman there who was very moved. She had her little toddler running around. She had a big pregnant belly. She was all dressed up to the nines because we had done this mommy makeover. And I sat there and I held her hands while she cried. And she said, you know, she didn't know how to provide for kids. She didn't know how to get out of this situation. There was this man that was really stalking her. And she had to move states and states away just to get away from him. Mm-hmm. And you think about what that does to that toddler that's right. in that shelter. And so she looked at me and she said, I am damaged. And that just broke my heart. And I'm thinking, we got to get this woman built up again so that she can reflect on the inside how she was looking at that moment on the outside. So building the moms up, building the children up, helping them with the educational component. And I told you yesterday on the other show that mommy now has a job. She's
That's
gotten
right.
away from the man. She's moved into an apartment, and I'm so proud of her. So there are definitely success stories out there.
And you know, even when we don't necessarily see the success stories right away, doesn't mean that they don't happen later.
Yes.
It doesn't mean that what I'm hearing from the story that you just spoke about was the first stone in the foundation.
Yes.
You know, not the whole foundation, but the first stone in the foundation of empowerment, confidence. Maybe it is a makeover where that parent sees their potential. And that potential, I think, can then transfer over to the children. Because if they feel confident as a parent, they'll make better decisions as a parent with their children.
Definitely.
Great stories so far. And I think that what you're doing, Dr. Shelley, is you're seeing, no, we're not just going to provide an education for homeless kids. We're going to make sure that the moms can get out of their rut and their situation and move forward.
Yes.
And I think that that's the key, to move forward so that we have less people homeless.
Yes.
So when we get back, we're going to talk more with Dr. Shelley about some of the other things she involving HCEF and learn more about her. You're watching Total Education with Neil, and we'll be back in just a moment.
Hello, everyone. I am Fiore, host and producer of Outtakes with Fiore here on BPTV, and it's not going to be too long. Short period of weeks before Outtakes celebrates its 500th episode. Now, in the research I've done, 500th episode is going to be a milestone not only for BPTV, but also for film review shows all across the nation. And we'd like you to be a part of it. If you've been a fan of the show for a good number of years, or if you've been a recent fan, we're inviting you to be part of the 500th episode show. All you need to do is give station director Dave Cable a call at this number, 412-831-3304. That's 412-831-3304. And you can come down to the studio and make your own taped greeting that will be part of the 500th episode. I know I'm going to be there. It's a milestone. Why don't you be part of it too? Call Dave Cable today at 412-831-3304. 3304.
Hi, my name is Acorn.
Hi, my name is Alex Barker, and the amazing!
I'm Jacob Wagner.
Hi, I'm Austin.
This is Scout 350, and you're watching BPTV. Isn't that awesome?
Co-host Jarrett, and also Dr. Shelley Hipsky. And Dr. Shelley has really talked about the great things that she's doing with HCEF, CEF, and also what I also like about it is not just that, but that we're helping eliminate homeless people who are homeless in certain ways by building them up so that we don't have to deal with this. But the surprise, which is a question I asked you at the beginning, that surprises me also, that I learned from the radio show a few years ago, but I don't know how many of our viewers know this, that you can't really spot a homeless child in school.
Mm-hmm.
And for teachers, administrators, and even parents that might have friends of that child, how do you spot that? Because a lot of times they're afraid to reach out for help, aren't they?
Absolutely. Well, we consider it very much a hidden dilemma because, for instance, until I met Roy Juarez from my fifth book with Ordinary People, Extraordinary Planet, I didn't have that person that could stand up at one of my big galas and say, I was homeless. It's very unusual for if you go to a cancer survivor dinner, you go to some of these different dinners, they will stand up and they will say it proud and loud. Right. Yes. But people that have been homeless tend to say, you know, that's my past. Yes. I don't want to deal with that. And I'm moving on and I'm already past that. So it is very much a hidden issue. And when I was a teacher, I remember looking for certain signals and signs. The dirty, unkept look, those type of things. But I think really for a teacher, for administrators, for parents that have friends that could be experiencing this, it's really building a relationship and having that conversation, which can be a very difficult conversation because there is that stigma attached to homelessness. And because a lot of people don't understand that it's not just the man on the street with a can anymore. No. This can be a kiddo that's couch surfing that doesn't know where they're going to land that evening, and they may be saying, oh my gosh, whose house am I going to sleep at tonight? Am I going to be able to convince my friend at school to take me in for an overnight so that I can have a place to lay my head instead of the car? So I think it is a tricky situation. When I was in Florida teaching, we had a lot of kids that were with the migrant working families, and they were experiencing very similar homeless type of issues. But it was, again, very hidden. Don't talk about it. You keep it quiet. You don't think about that side. But these are kids that are in need.
And let's go back to a little bit more. What could we be doing, or what did you do first as a vice principal, an educator, even now moving into your college experience with your students? You've identified these students, you've identified the need. What can we do now to step in and make it more long-term, not a one-day service?
Right, absolutely.
Because these folks, unfortunately, are used to the people coming in for that one-day service. How do we show these folks, and especially the children, that we're committed, that we're going to take that step and stay with them?
Absolutely. I would consider those like drive-by charity works. Like, yes. It's just like bam, 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 right. And correct. We're out of here. And I don't think that's healthy for the person that's doing the volunteer work. I don't think it's healthy for the people that are receiving the care. I personally have made a commitment to volunteer and advise the board, and I do these huge gala performances, and I coordinate my students to go and to help in the shelters. And I, like I said, I bring my own family, and my daughter is like all about it. She's 6 years old. Like, she loves it. My kids, Neil, this is truth. Like, you know how most kids will like play princess and dress up and stuff. Right. My kids are playing charity now. That's their new game. They're like, I'm going to organize this for the homeless. And I'm like, well, that's so cute, but it's good. And so I think that also in getting the next generation involved, role modeling for them, that it's not a one-shot deal, that you go out and you make a difference in people's lives, because it can happen.
And Jarrett likes always to go backwards, and that's the educator in him saying, I didn't ask that right question yet, and I want to ask it, so let's go back to identification.
What is that right question?
That identification is so key, but I can help you on that, because
it's absolutely the key.
So if we're IDing this, I remember we're talking to Roy about this.
Yes.
And I remember when he talked about the couch surfing and how to spot these things. And I think things are worse than when he was on the show with us. Our economy in certain ways.
Absolutely.
Of people are not willing to identify they're homeless when they had really good jobs.
Yes.
And since something just happened and they couldn't pay, they were thrown out of their house.
Yes.
They're going from a hotel to hotel. A hotel is a consideration of homelessness as well, because you're going from one hotel to the next hotel, and it's just not a proper environment for kids to learn in, right?
Yeah, absolutely. It's not stable for them. And when we think hotel, we might think of like a nice hotel, but they're not four stars, not a suite. Yes, exactly. So there are definitely children all around America that are experiencing this form of homelessness. And we've been mentioning Roy Roraz Jr., and he is with the Homeless by Choice Tour, and he's doing an amazing job. He's spoken to over 100,000 people about when he was homeless as a child with his brothers and sisters. And he just does a fantastic job of sort of spreading that message from his perspective. There are so many wonderful organizations out there, like Homeless by Choice, like HCEF, another one that I work with Ordinary People, Extraordinary Planet, it's very tied to the economy, like you were saying. It's Mary Kay Hood Hood's organization, Kids Food Basket, and I'm not sure if you guys are aware of, oh my gosh, she is brilliant. So she feeds over 1,000 kids a day in the Michigan school districts because it's right there where the car manufacturing plants shut down. And these parents that could provide, they could put their meals on the table, they couldn't anymore. And her friend who was a principal came to her one day and said, I'm heartbroken. And she said, why? And she said that she saw these kids digging through the dumpster outside the school.
Okay, so there's one indicator that we can see. Yes, absolutely. They were scavenging for food. With either within the school, maybe begging for, asking for another, are you finished with that fruit cup? May I have it?
Yes.
So there's an indicator that teachers and community can search for.
Well, when I was a kid, I had what would be considered a bully today, and she will remain nameless because, you know, this is going on TV, but she would take my lunch bag every day, and she would take out the Ziploc baggies that my mother would prepare so cute and so nice, and she would open them up, and she would go, and spit in each of my little baggies. And I was like, ew. You know, I was like, oh, this is so gross because it's fourth grade. And I was like, why is this girl doing this to me? And I'd go home and I'd cry and I'd say, Mom, she's spitting in my lunch. I can't eat my lunch. But we found out that she came from a very low socioeconomic household. Her mommy couldn't make lunch and she was so out of it that she couldn't even fill out the paperwork for the free and reduced lunch. So then my mom started packing an extra bag. So yeah, definitely look for, are they in that food survival mode? That's a huge key.
That's again, when we look at these things that we have to spot, that's a great point. A lot of times bullies are out there because they're hurt.
Yes.
They're destroyed in certain ways. Mm-hmm. Dr. Shelley, and this is for another topic, but it's a good point to make that a lot of times some of the bullies out there, we always say we're going to blame the parents. It's the environment they're in within, and you were able to spot that. So mm-hmm. that's a fantastic part of the indication. When also with the couch serving, going from one relative to the next relative to the next relative, that's got to be hard as well on them, because how can they wake up the next morning and go to school feeling like that?
Right, absolutely. Yeah. There's just that foundation that's missing, and they need that. They need that stability and routine. You think about how kids thrive on routine, and they just don't have that. So it's important organizations like HDEF come in and they provide some of that stability for the children, which is so lovely.
Absolutely.
Now, you've mentioned the organization, the work that you have done, your students are doing. I want to ask a very serious and tough question here. Is we know that the people that watch cable access are involved in their communities.
Yes.
Why do we need to be doing this? So many of us could say, it's not our problem. You know, yes, I feel bad. There's sympathy. I even feel sorrow. It's not our problem. There's a government program for that. I want you to explain, why are you doing this and why do we need to be involved?
Oh my gosh, my heart just like went, because I, first of all, I can't imagine that there's people that are watching this show that wouldn't say, oh my goodness, I want to help a homeless child. Like, just because they're hidden doesn't mean they're not hurting.
Right, exactly.
And we have to reach out. And I mean, if you look to the future, do you want productive members of society, or do you want kids that are growing up to do criminal acts, that are doing different things that, you know, are going to affect our lives very, very personally? For me and for you and for your audience, I'm sure they're thinking, I can tell you, I go into the shelters all the time, and I held this little four-day-old baby who came right from the homeless shelter from the hospital after the mommy gave birth. And she had four other kids running around beside her. Somebody's got to think about those other kids and that little itty-bitty sweetheart of a child that needs some love and nurturing and to be, you know, just taken care of. I mean, the children of the world are our children.
The first component of learning for a four-day-old. Four-day-olds are learning at that point, and they're learning about trust.
Mm-hmm.
And they're learning that mom or dad meet their needs.
Yeah.
It's the most basic form of learning,
exactly. Yes.
But it's still learning. And if it's not taking place at day four, it's affecting that child. And I know
so
that sounds
innocent.
Crazy.
I mean, his baby
maybe.
Was so sweet exactly. and so cute and so innocent. And you're thinking, you didn't do anything to get yourself in this situation, like at
exactly.
all. I definitely think that HDEF is doing wonders and other
right.
organizations out there.
Because the government's not going to be able to take care of things quickly. And again, the resources are out there mm-hmm. are not enough. You know how many
right.
kids I taught at St. Agnes that their breakfast or their lunch was luckily the only good meal they're going to have all day.
Yeah.
And that even though the check does come, it's spent on other things sometimes. And it's not spent on food, or it's spent on, or other people are utilizing it in other ways. So
right.
we have to look at, somebody else could be, so we have this, how the foundation's able to help people,
mm-hmm.
especially firsthand seeing them be fed, educated, such a unbelievable important thing, isn't it?
Absolutely.
And really what's amazing about some of the fundraising is the people in the community that have been involved in this. Tell us a
yes.
bit of some of the things you've done on fundraisers. They're unbelievable.
Oh,
she's
my goodness.
A planner. She shows the teaching completely with this planning. I mean, she does a lesson plan out and says, okay, let me set up another one.
It's an unusual lesson plan, though. Let me tell you.
Those are the kind I like.
Yeah. Oh, but they're so fun.
They're my favorite.
Yeah, it's because I put on like these huge like cabaret-type performances, Broadway style. We did one over at the Priory, Taste of Broadway.
Nice.
225 people were there. We brought in 13 people from L.A. and New York, and I headlined, had a lot of fun with that, singing and dancing. I have a blast on stage. So I put together these big events. On August 9th, I'm doing Shopping for a Cause, and that's all Italian shoes and Italian accessories and European clothing. So the ladies are all like, woohoo, let's do this. And that's in Shadyside. So okay. I'm definitely finding unique ways to get the community excited about fundraising and getting HDEF on that map and sort of in people's brains
exactly.
of, yes, we need to help these kids.
And when we get back, I want to learn more about what Dr. Shelley's doing, a couple of the others, some of the major athletes that are involved in this, and I guess also how our listeners can get involved more, volunteering, things like that, and look to the future of where you want to be philanthropically with a lot of the different foundations you're working with. You're watching Total Education with Neil, and we'll be back in just a moment.
PPTV, come volunteer. If it wasn't fun, I wouldn't be here.
TV. Come on in, make a show. It's still fun after all these years.
We're back to Total Education with Neil, and when I take a month off of TV, it's not like radio where I'm just living in my basement, in my studio, doing radio. This
like
is something
a, that's
where this
troll like. We don't want to stay here living in your basement.
That's where his wife confronts him, by the way, in the basement.
No,
I have a wish is finished. You know, donations are always there for me. But we're talking
about
Jared.
I'm not raising
also,
funds for your man cave. That's not happening.
Oh, come on. Something. No, but we're with Dr. Shelley Hipsky and also. Jared, as I always like to pin phrase that. But we're talking about HCEF, the Homeless Children's Education Fund, and also some of the cool things you're doing. You talked about some of the other things in the years but also there are other major people in Pittsburgh
absolutely.
That are involved
well,
in the organization and internationally in certain ways because of how you've brought connections and through your book and all these different things. So tell us a couple of the stories. And then Jared will have some follow-up questions for us.
One you can actually YouTube. If you put in RMU Cabaret Professor on YouTube. There is Brett Kiesel and myself and Joe Lagana. And Brett is, if I could think of one person in the Pittsburgh community that has really just rallied around the Homeless Children's Education Fund, it is that big burly steeler with the beard. So he's a wonderful human being. His wife is fantastic. His kids are great. And they have just really embraced this movement of helping the homeless children of Pittsburgh.
I mean, that's the fantastic thing. Jared and I have been blown away with athletes on my radio show have really been so passionate about foundations that are involved.
Yeah, it appears that, you know, the common thread here is that they have, they feel like they have been blessed with a gift, and now they are looking to bless other people, you know, to give their talents and take them out into the community. And we hear so many recently the negative stories associated with so many athletes, and yet there is such a strong community of athletes who are so committed to the broad issues that are facing the greatest challenges within our communities.
And you know what's very surprising, Dr. Shelley? Out of all the sports, the NFL is probably the most involved with charities that are willing to go on the radio, willing to do TV interviews. It's very surprising. I don't know if it's because of the number of the athletes, but they're high-profile athletes mm-hmm. that are involved in this. It's a lot more difficult to pull Major League Baseball involvement or the NHL compared to. But I know that other people, so have any other athletes been involved in any of the work with HCEF?
There certainly are, and none are coming to my mind.
That's okay.
I'm an artsy fartsy girl. I'm not a sports motivated woman. I'm sorry, Pittsburgh. But no, so they don't pop to my head. But when you mentioned sort of the global perspective that this whole thing has taken on with Inspiring Lives with my company, and one of the people that came in to Robert Morris to be our international scholar, Getrud Mache, who has done amazing things in Africa. She actually brought the Love My Whoopee blankets to the AIDS orphans in Africa, and I brought them to the Pittsburgh homeless shelters. Wow. So, and that's it. Love My Whoopee is a company that like donates a blanket. Every time you buy one of these high-end, beautiful blankets, you get one for a kid in need. And so Getrud and I met through that project. Then she came here to Robert Morris, co-taught with me in the classroom, I teach undergrad to doctoral students. And so then she went with me to the homeless shelter one day with her son, Simba, and we painted this amazing mural. And the kids loved it. And, you know, murals are a fantastic way to kind of jazz up a kind of institutional type of space and make it really welcoming. And you think about, like, that 4-day-old baby that we were talking about in the homeless shelter with the little toddlers running around. They're looking up, and now they're seeing a jungle. They're not just seeing a very cold type of perspective. They're saying, oh, that's a jaguar, that's this. And so they're starting to get their little brains working in a positive, more imaginative way.
And of course, the Pittsburgh connection to Whoopi is Michael Keaton and Mr. Mom. That was my little pop culture reference.
Wow.
Here. That was, I mean, yes, it goes back a few years, and certainly so it shows my age. But that's where Whoopi comes from, is Mr. Mom.
Fantastic! Now, I didn't even connect that.
I remember that.
I'm remembering it now.
Absolutely. Now, you've mentioned the celebrities, the people that are in the community that are coming forward. Do you identify these people, or do you have people actually coming to you to say, what can I do to help?
Oh my gosh, I can tell you, I have the most amazing network of people, and you know that from the radio show, like, they come to me in droves, and I help them to figure out what their skill sets are and what charities they should help and what they can bring to the table. I'm not the person that does that for HCEF. Susie mm-hmm. Robinson is, and people can go to www.homelessfund.org to find more information, get the phone number, contact Susie. She will find you that niche area of what, maybe it's sitting down and reading a book in a homeless shelter to some kids, or maybe it's helping me put together a fabulous gala. You never know till you call.
And so that was a great question that Jared asked, but again, I think that the entire community of Pittsburgh, other business organizations mm-hmm. are involved in this and helping with the fund. I remember for Grasso Group, right?
They do wonderful things. Yes, really Bob. Yes,
Bob was, yeah.
Great guy. And yeah, so there's a lot of wonderful community support that have just rallied around it. And it's wonderful to see that a community can really, you know, Pittsburgh's like a little village. We're taking care of our own, and that's good. You know, we really need to do that and in any way possible. And I think that people tend to think, oh, it's a charity. I have to be philanthropic. I have to give money. But very often, yes, it's a money, but you could go see a show and help out, or you could go buy some fabulous shoes at Shopping for a Cause, or you could go to the homeless shelters and sit down with a mom and show her how to do a budget.
Yes.
Whatever you're doing, whatever skill set you bring to the table is a blessing to that person and to the overall Pittsburgh community.
Men's shoes? I'm looking at my shoes right now, and I'm glad that the camera can't see it. Yeah. And I definitely need a new pair of
consultant that needs to consult you on this, G.J. Reynolds, my business partner.
There you go.
You should have seen the bling shoes he had on in Orlando. They had to focus on those in the camera. They were silver.
Wait.
Oh, my gosh. You have to see.
Wait. Can we do a close-up?
These are
bling shoes.
Oh, there you go.
I will show you the picture. You will be absolutely amazed. If you talk about fashion, my business partner, G.J. Reynolds, is Mr. Fashion.
Awesome. I'll have to meet him.
I don't have that fashion sense.
Well, we can absolutely see that. I mean, that's something that we've known for a while. But Shelly's here.
We're still on topic.
Shelly is here. You're going to get us back on topic.
Fantastic.
So let's jump in now.
Yes.
The ordinary person or anyone that's watching this show right now, how do we know that we can help out? You kind of gave us some ideas, but specifically enough, give us some stories. I'm waiting for some stories of people, ordinary people, that goes back that, when you talk about their extraordinary lives, and help the HCEF in ways. To be involved, that can be mentioned.
Absolutely. I mean, I think I have to go back to my galas. I mean, there's so many people that just come on board and take care of business. I mean, Julie Walcott is the fabulous judge's wife here in town, and she loves to make these like chocolate covered pretzels, and they're amazing, and everybody loves them. They devour them, and so at my galas, she's always like, "I'll take care of the chocolate covered pretzel. You gotta grab a chocolate covered pretzel
and take
it
to gala."
I know, me too. So yeah, so I mean, it's whatever you're good at. Everybody's got a gift inside them. Everybody,
yes.
And if it's chocolate covered pretzels, or if it's, my goodness, if it's singing a song, belting out a number. Yeah. I can get you on the stage with me. That'll be fun. So yeah, there's always a way.
And I like the word that you used there. Ordinary people, but you move beyond extraordinary.
Yes.
I mean, we all have as we're ordinary people.
Yes.
We all have the potential, the ability, just need the opportunity and the chance to participate to go from ordinary to extraordinary.
Absolutely. That's why my book is Ordinary People, Extraordinary Planet. And it's all people that have conquered obstacles in their life, risen above, and now go on and help other people.
So for our international audiences, Jarrett always likes to say our flagship station, which is cable access, but however, it's on in many different communities in the area. So just to plug that, but also our international audience that watches this on YouTube all over the mm-hmm. world, how can they model this? If they're in a city and they say, "I would like to start something like this," what recommendations would you give them? I always ask hard questions. If you've ever,
you do. You I like a good hard question. I like a challenge.
You're not going to keep your secret. You're going to let it out there.
Well, she didn't know that she knows from
yes.
working with them
yes.
hand in hand, but I
absolutely.
Think that she would love to see it, especially when there are organizations like this across the country, but I don't know as good as this one, and
yeah.
especially regarding education. I'd love to see it in more places.
Definitely. And so I'm a huge believer in collaboration. I think that you need to reach out via social media in your community and find ways to find others that are passionate about what you're passionate about and then go forward. I mean, if you want to get into the logistics of forming a nonprofit, that's one thing. But for example, on Monday of this week, I was Skyped into a South African classroom and helped lead a power circle for 11th grade girls. And it was amazing. It was incredible. So we can, in this day and age, go incredibly global, incredibly quickly, and form these relationships, connections, and help other people.
Neil, I am so out of touch with modern technology.
We know that.
I haven't Skyped. I don't have Twitter.
Oh my God!
I really
he doesn't
need
have Facebook.
I don't even have Facebook.
Oh no,
right.
No Facebook.
Yeah, so you can't talk.
I'm on Facebook.
You can't talk Jared.
I have a flip phone that can't even get the internet. So, but
you're not going to tag Jared or anything.
No.
Or anything involving that.
It's a shame.
So that's a great example. Great story. One other story. To jump in another story before we get a break, but I think that when you're saying about South Africa, but other cities modeling this, contact the website's a key component.
I would say homelessfund.org is the way to go.
Joe would really want Lugano.
Oh my goodness, absolutely.
As an educator himself, he would just jump at the fact of doing this. And here's another question, are there organizations like that around the country, like when you were learning from Roy, that are doing this or to this scale, do you think?
I think that there are. There's a homeless education network that's out there. There's some wonderful big conferences. We actually had one of the main ones here at the Rivers Club in Pittsburgh recently. And so it's really just getting out there and finding like-minded people. Even if you have a flip phone, it's okay.
There's very few of us left the like-minded. Yes, very few of us like-minded like that.
You know, that phone will probably disappear at one point.
I think so.
It will definitely disappear. But no, I think that's a great point when you're talking about the whole thing with involving that. Because, I mean, I think that other organizations need to step up. And that network, but you don't know how many that are just modeled on that. There are many people helping the homeless, but not
right.
education.
Not this particular component. And it's so vital because they are right in the shelters and really helping with that transition. And I've seen it live. And, well, okay, I can give you one more quickie example. I think we're starting to close this out. I went to the Social Justice Conference, which was held at Duquesne University, and Joe brought a group of us from the conference that are scholars to the shelter. And we sat there and we talked and we asked questions and we saw all the wonderful learning resources they had. And I said, if you could have one thing for this shelter, what would it be? And her face just lit up. She was like, oh, a we. If we could have a we, and I was like, a we? Are you serious? But when I brought that we, I found a donor that, like, I got on my cell phone right as I was driving away from the shelter. I got a donor and we got a we. But it was because those kids can't go outside and play. They don't have the, because there's, you know, they're, some of the fathers and things like that are sort of after them. So they can't be seen. They're very hidden away. So that getting that physical education is a hard thing for them to do because they can't go outside and play. But so they had a blast with that. We had so much fun when we brought that in and, you know, they're playing pretend tennis and doing the bowling and boxing and all that good stuff. And so really asking, what do you need, is a vital thing. And volunteering.
All right, when we get back, we want to find out what's next for Dr. Shelley with this foundation and other philanthropic things she does. You're watching Total Education with Neil, and we'll be back in just a moment.
Hello, everyone. I am Fiore, host and producer of Outtakes with Fiore here on BPTV, and it's not going to be too long. Short period of weeks before Outtake celebrates its 500th episode. Now, in the research I've done, 500th episode is going to be a milestone not only for BPTV, but also for film review shows all across the nation. And we'd like you to be a part of it. If you've been a fan of the show for a good number of years, or if you've been a recent fan, we're inviting you to be part of the 500th episode show. All you need to do is give station director Dave Cable a call at this number, 412-831-3304. That's 412-831-3304, and you can come down to the studio and make your own taped greeting that will be part of the 500th episode. I know I'm going to be there. It's a milestone. Why don't you be part of it too? Call Dave Cable today at 412-831-3304.
back to Total Education with Neil. I haven't told you where you can follow me. Facebook, Neil S. Haley, Twitter, Total Tutor, and TotalTutor.net. And listen to the radio show in Pittsburgh on 1080 WWNL on AM on Saturdays at 7 a.m. and 3 p.m. and the Total Education Hour on 9 a.m. Eastern on Thursday and 4:30 p.m. drive time on Friday. And Jared and I really get in arguments in that one, but people weren't surprised about arguments in last week.
Neil, I'm sorry, I have to interrupt. I have to get out my modern technology and actually send a text message to someone here. Look, amazing. I'm using both of my thumbs. There it is, folks. There's my
That's not as ugly as I thought it was going to be.
I remember when he said, I'm just going to start texting. It's not been 7 years, Jared.
This phone is about seven,
no, no,
six
five,
years old.
5 years okay. old. Okay, there goes his memory. So, okay. So let's go from there.
Reel him back in.
See, Michelle, that's the thing. You know, we're in this. This is my show. I can do what I want.
It is your show.
Exactly. So let's go right to specifically what do you think's next? You said the next event coming up is August 7th, right?
August 9th is Shopping for a Cause, and that is to raise funds for the Homeless Children's Education Fund. And that's wonderful because for the ladies out there that like fashion, so the shoes there are incredible. 200 shoe stores in Italy, only one in the United States, right here in Shadyside in Pittsburgh. So, and Barbara Gambito owns that store, and she's opened it up to the ladies to come in and the husbands and boyfriends to come in and get fabulous shoes and fantastic finds to give a portion of the proceeds to the Homeless Children's Education Fund. I also do a lot of keynoting. I'm doing the United Way Powerful Connections for Women on August 2nd over at Slippery Rock University. And whenever I talk about my charitable contributions and how other people can help and give back.
So we're talking about August 9th. How can our viewers get involved and help out? Is there anything left, or is it pretty much to go to the website? It's a big thing.
Okay, so for that, they would have to Facebook me, and then I could get them an invite. It's a very
is your Facebook full yet? It's not.
I have to pare it down because I go backwards on the Facebook on people that I actually I have a connection with. But it's great, and social media has been a wonderful platform for connecting people for different charitable events.
So
definitely.
They contact you on Facebook then, and it's. Yes. Shelly Hipsky, is that?
It is Shelly Hipsky, and that's spelled Hip Sky, so that they can remember.
that's a great one, and that's a great one as well. So where do you think's next? And
what do I think is next?
HCF, and next
for HCF.
Year, where are you looking next?
Well, in October, we're going to have this one everybody could look into. At the Priory, we're going to have a 9-piece salsa band and tear it up on the dance floor. You coming?
Salsa.
Get you around the dance floor?
Look at this. This vest
He's
says.
He's ready. He's
this
ready.
This vest says salsa.
Are you going to wear that?
I have multiple vests.
Fantastic.
I can wear the best one.
I'm going to be on the lookout for what vest you're wearing on the dance floor. A little.
I even might have a puffy shirt left.
Fantastic.
You're going to bring the puppet shirt next month.
I will do that for you.
But yes, that one will definitely be on the HCEF website. The governor's office has been very involved now in helping us promote the events and promote all the different things I'm doing with HCEF and Inspiring Lives. And so it's been a wonderful movement towards with the television show and the radio show and the books and the everything that's going on. I feel very blessed to have this network of people that want to help and give back.
Absolutely. And Jarrett, I know that you have questions also pertaining to some of the other charitable causes that Dr. Shelley's involved in.
Yes, I was finally glad I could ask that question. But, you know, I'm curious about something. We've known each other for several years, haven't been back involved for a little bit of time. I'd like to know, and I ask this question of so many people, but and I mean it when I ask it. I'd like to know what was it that led you to this path? I mean, you could have gone so many different paths, focused on professions, focused on career, and yet there's this strong sense of community involvement, assisting people in need. And I'm incredibly impressed with the empowering women. I mean, words matter, and I say this all the time, both good words and negative words. Empowering is such a positive word, connecting that with women. And I mean this when I ask it, what led you in this direction?
Family. Okay. Absolutely. I can look to my childhood growing up, and we were always volunteering. And my mother in particular, when the AIDS epidemic hit in our hometown, she ran the local theater. And so she was deeply affected with many friends that were affected with HIV and AIDS. And she got me and my brother and my dad, and we were going into the shelter and making dinner, or I would put on an elf costume and hand out Christmas presents. So like whatever it took to get a smile on these people's faces, we did. And that was just a part of how I was raised and how I was nurtured growing up, how I'm raising my children now. And I've seen that even with my books and my TV show and everything. People that give were very often raised in that it's just a part of who you are. You just have that passion intrinsically to give back and help others. And if everybody would go out and use their skill sets to help others, oh my goodness, what an amazing world.
Because they can. Everyone
yes,
can
absolutely.
Do that. And if you
aren't
raised necessarily in that environment of I'm going to give back, and we know this with our sports celebrities,
yes.
So many of them grew up with such desperate needs, mm-hmm. and yet they have in turn given back. So it can happen at any moment. For those of us, for those in our viewing audience, it can happen at any moment. It can be that lightning
exactly.
bolt,
yes.
that switch.
Yes, absolutely.
And so basically, you talk about some of the organizations. Talk about some other ones that you're involved philanthropically with, because you're
oh my gosh, there's so many.
That's where I know that's a segment in itself.
Yes, absolutely. So I'll do a Pittsburgh and a global. Can I do that? Okay. So Pittsburgh, Treasure House Fashions recently appointed the board. I do the emceeing for their big fashion shows. They are amazing. They've helped over 10,000 women in the Pittsburgh area alone. 60 charities. They help women from the Western Psych women to women that are homeless. So they're just fantastic. And they have a fabulous mission. And they can hear about that on our show, Empowering Women, on the radio. But the one that globally I've had a huge connection with is the There's No Limit Foundation, and that's Mariama Nassada Camara, and they came from Guinea, Africa, and they worked with the women there that made tie-dyes, took them back, put them on the runways of New York City, New York Fashion Week actually, with Tory Burch, the fabulous designer, and then they take those funds and put it back into the education and the empowerment of the women back in their home village, which I just think is a fantastic model. So it can be anything. It can be fashion, it can be finance, it could be just a smile that can brighten someone's day.
And what Shelly does using her brand, Jared, which is amazing, is she'll take her television show, now her radio show, and connect people to help each other and empower women. And that's what, and inspire people in so many ways. The downtrodden, the people that really need that help. And I see it all the time. You're talking about, oh, I just mentioned two charities. We could spend a lot more time.
We could spend hours on different charities I love.
The television show, how that's taken off when you were looking at your some of your books and just all of it together. But remember, she's still a professor, professor at Robert Morris University. She doesn't sleep. She's on the phone. So how you're able to do all this is amazing. But I think how you connect people. And that's another great, and that's why, again, you're involved in a lot of with women's business and stuff as well.
Yes, absolutely.
You're a connector. And, mm-hmm. and that's a key component to this whole thing as well. But you always see there's another opportunity for another person that I've met that really is transforming people's lives, right?
Absolutely. And I think you're a connector too, Neil, obviously. We know that about you. But I connecting people is it's such a natural thing for me because I know people, and since I'm interviewing constantly, I know their life stories, what they're passionate
exactly.
about, and I can just make that match very easily. Oh my gosh, I'm starting to sound like a match.com or something. I'm not that kind of girl. I'm not going to be able to match you up with the right person for a relationship. I can find
can
maybe
be
a chip. Oh
that
my god.
Another career. Let's
matchmaker. No.
I thought you meant for me. I was going to say I'm happily married, so you know. Okay.
Yes, no, I can definitely help you find the right avenue for your skills. That's something I love to do.
Well, absolutely. And so where do you see yourself in 10 years? So yeah, it's very interesting where I go into questions.
Wow.
Where do you want to be in 10 years? And I think that's so important to look at that because your brand continues to grow. Where do you want to see yourself?
Where do I want to see myself in 10 years? I want to see myself with my kids happy doing what I love to do, which I'm doing right now. I mean, I love every component. I have a busy life. I definitely have a busy life. But I love every component of it, and I just want to take it bigger, broader, more global.
Yes. She needs a handler, Jared. She needs a handler.
Yeah, I don't even know what that term means.
I hope I don't need a handler.
Huh?
An agent? Is that what
it
is?
Okay.
A handler.
An assistant that takes care of all
Yes.
I mean, there's so much. I mean, I try to make sure I do this, and Jared's like, how are you able to do it, Neil? You ask me that all the time, right?
I do ask you that all the time.
You don't sleep. You never sleep. That's the thing. with four kids, you're not going to sleep. No, especially a little one, it's never going to happen.
Not gonna happen.
So if you were telling people right now how you empower women, because we've always asked that question on our show, how do you empower women? How would you answer that question?
I would say that I have a mission that I'm very passionate about, which is to globally educate, entertain, and inspire. And under that heading, I do so many things as far as reaching out and taking, you know what, it really comes down to I help take care of my friends and then they take care of me and then we see each other's skills and goals and we reach them together. I mean, it's all about collaboration as opposed to competition.
Now, we are really seeing Dr. Shelley without a script, without anything.
Without the script, without the thing in my ear that I have in my show.
And I love this because, and this is interesting, Jared, because again, when we interviewed her in her first book, one of her first books, and it was on WRCT, we really didn't get to know the Dr. Shelley that we know today. It's amazing.
No, we didn't. And Neil, how many times on our show have we talked about, you said, and I two important words that I want our audience to hear again. It's about collaboration, not competition.
Yes.
How many times have we talked about that within the very first radio shows we did, that our society does not need to be as competitive.
Absolutely.
But I'd like you to share that again, collaboration and not competition.
Yes, yes. I have a dear friend who is the editor of Inspirational Woman magazine, and they focused on me, and it's a European magazine. She says that women should not compete, they should complete each other by helping each other fill in those gaps, and I think that that's vital.
Well, I cannot believe we've run out of time. I want to thank again Jared to becoming my co-host.
Thank you.
Happy that you come. Did you come on the train again or not? You drove.
I love the train. A wonderful ride. And I'd encourage all Pittsburghers, get on that subway
and
system.
For Dr. Shelley to take the time to come here.
Absolutely. It was a joy.
And, you know, we're on the phone every week together, but now seeing you in person and seeing where you're going and where you're headed. So quickly, website, find more info on you.
www.shelleyhipsky.com. You can
and
find
Jared,
out.
You can find him on his flip phone. And for me, it's www.totaltutor.net and also Twitter, Total Tutor, and Neil S. Haley, Facebook. Hope everyone has a great month, and we'll talk next month with some more great TV. Good day, everyone.